Bob, we just talked to Malik and Polly, but start with Malik. Just, what's his development been like? What do you think of him?
I think he's been really good. He's gotten better defensively. He's been our one guy who consistently we could give the ball to and he scored.
When you went after him in the transfer portal, is you getting what you thought you would from him?
Yeah, pretty much. I talked to Jeff quite a bit about it, and pretty much what Jeff said.
Your thoughts on Oklahoma style wise? What do you see from them today?
Look at you.
I'm all covered up here.
I'm sorry.
Looking like a mummy? Is that your?
Yeah, a little muffled as well.
Sorry. Oklahoma.
They're really good. They run great offense. He's done a great job with them. He's done a great job putting the team together. And they've been in. You know, they had a chance to beat Kansas. They had a chance to beat Baylor. You know, they led both of them late in the game. So he's done a terrific job with them.
He inherited, you know, players. Does he incorporate his style into it? Do they just do a blend kind of like you did with John when you inherited John's players, or is he doing his own thing?
He inherited four. That's not very many.
Okay.
No, I don't know which four it was, but he I know,
so
well,
it's all his stuff.
I don't know. It was Shambi and Fran, so I'm not sure that's the truth, but.
So it's his stuff.
But he did. He inherited four guys.
Is the scout different for a coach you haven't faced? In the past? I mean, you hardly probably have to look at Bill Self's stuff, but is it different for a guy like Parker Moser?
He runs a variation of a lot of really good stuff that a lot of really good coaches, and I think his background with Rick Majerus certainly has helped them. But they do great things. They're great at back cutting you. They're great at when you start watching the ball back cutting. They do a great job of opening up driving lanes so they can drive it at the rim. I really like their team.
Are they more defensive minded than they used to be, maybe? Have decent defensive numbers.
I think they're really good defensively, but I don't know. Oklahoma was pretty good when Lon was there, and Lon always had rim protectors. Shot blockers. I mean, they beat us twice on guys defending the rim at the end of games. But I mean, they do a great job. They got a couple guys who rebound it really well out of their area. Kind of like a John Holden was for us. You know, John rebounded out of his area. They've got guys that rebounded out of their area.
Ask Paulie, I'll ask you. Looks like your guys are still learning each other on the floor. Do you have enough time to get them where they need to be? I mean, you're basically just drinking from a fire hose, getting these guys to play off each other. I mean, there were instances where guys got hit in the back with passes, and a guy might be going for a rebound when he's dumping it down, things like that.
I wondered why we turned it over so much. They don't know each other, I guess. Having the same color uniform on ought to be just a clue for them, you know. But we're not. We haven't passed it very well. We threw one at Texas Tech that hit our guy in the shoulder, hit one of their guys, bounced up in the air, and we got it back. And he, the guy he hit, he wasn't throwing it to him. So, yeah, it's been a, that part of it's really been a challenge.
Can you fix it?
I'm going to try like crazy.
I guess sort of the same question, rebounding. Obviously, that's been an issue at times, too. So,
yeah, you know, I mean, we've been good at times and not very good at times. I mean, I think a lot of that has to do with who you play, obviously, as well. But and really, we haven't been able to play two bigs as much as what, you know, I'd kind of like to play two bigs, because we have to find some guys who can score and hopefully help other people score. And we've had a hard time finding two bigs that were could work together in that regard.
Kind of take the glass half full when you look at what you've done the last three games against these teams. I mean, you had Texas Tech down in the second half. A defending national champ, you were right there with them second half. Halftime up to Kansas. I mean, is it a matter of making winning plays at times, or how do you view it with your guys?
I've never been very satisfied with losing, and we lost, and we had some opportunities that we had blown opportunities. But, you know, I mean, a lot of things happen, you know, a bad pass, a missed shot, we missed 11 shots inside 2 feet. 11. How you gonna win? You know, but we did. We missed 11 shots inside of 2 feet. Not gonna win when that happens.
Hey Bob, two of their transfers are kind of interesting guys. Goldwire's from Duke in the ACC, and we didn't play a ton. Groves is the big sky. Forget. Played a lot, but not against competition. They come from different ends.
Who was the second one?
Groves.
Yeah.
So really kind of two different examples about, you know, one guy who's probably like a blue chip, but maybe never got a chance, and one guy who's played like a blue chip, but came from, I guess, a more obscure spot. How research does the portal have to be so you know where you can project what you're going to get?
Well, some of those guys are before the portal, and the little fellow he tore us apart twice. I think he got 28 twice. He can really shoot the ball. He came from North Texas. And that was a transfer. That wasn't a portal deal. That was a year before. They did a great job in a portal. Had to do a great job in a portal if you only got four guys back. I mean, and honestly, I mean, we probably didn't do a very good job in a portal.
So that said, as you look forward at the portal, because it's going to be here, so what do you fix in your terms of how do you do better in the portal?
We have people watching it every day. We've got people watching it every day, and... you know, honestly, I'm kind of the opinion that it's, I don't want to say it's not good for college basketball, but I don't think it's good for your fans. You know, you have a guy come in and he's there for a little while and then he's gone, and not, you know, you don't have the Deshaun Butlers and the Joe Alexanders and Kevin Joneses and you know, on and on and on that, you know, I don't think, you know, years from now, our fans are going to be talking about a guy who was here for a year, unless he did something spectacular. You know, I kind of favor the deal of having guys here, and you know, and the other thing is, I mean, academically, I mean, for all that's talked about, you know, the academics and this and that. I mean, I'd like to see the numbers of those guys that actually got academically what they set out to do. Because we heard about it forever, you know, ever.
About rating people's rosters. I mean, when you got in this business, you respected people's teams and rosters. And
most guys did.
Well, most guys did.
Yeah.
But, I mean, now it's like, well, okay, I'm going to look at that team and say, oh, who do I want?
I would think that it'd be easier now.
Yeah.
I mean, because there's so many handlers out there that you don't recruit the kid anymore, really. I wouldn't think. I mean, you guys know I don't want to do that. And I don't really want to have 1 year guys, or certainly not very many 1 year guys. But you're not going to win with 13 freshmen.
Could this damage the overall quality of the game down the road? You got guys going from one place to the next, and you talk about playing together.
I don't know if it damages the game, John, but I think it's hard on the fans. I mean, I really do. I think it's hard on the fans. I mean, you know. As kids, you know, you take those pictures and you put them up on your wall and you hang them on your door, and you know what I mean? I mean, I remember growing up in Doug Hill, and you know, I'd go in and my grandfather put me a little hoop up right there, and it was right in front of the coal bin, which my mother didn't like much, because you know, I was in there getting shots up whenever at halftime, and come back in there with coal dust all over me. My mom had to, you know, send me up to get another bath. But I don't know, growing up that way, I think kids miss out. I mean, quite frankly, I think they do. I think they miss out. You know, and you get attached to a guy, and then he's gone. Where is he? Where'd he go? I guess he
sent a message to a player, okay, if I can't beat this guy out, I'll leave. I'll go someplace else.
Well, that's what's happening, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think. I don't know. I'm not a good one to ask, because I don't fool around with it very much. I just see guys, you know, didn't I just see that guy, you know, last year at another place? It's kind of, and we got in it. I mean, we had to get in it just because of numbers and everything, but.
You think it affects the product on the court? I guess some people who are in their first year, it might take a long time to just learn to get to a certain spot.
I think it does for some kids, yeah. Some kids, not all kids, some of them. Shouldn't say kids, players. Some players, I think it does. Some players, it probably doesn't.
You use junior college a lot. Are junior college players different than portal players in your experience?
I honestly didn't use junior college players as much as I got credit for. We did early on. We didn't have any choice. You know, when you come in and you got three guys or four guys in a program, you've got to go get some people somewhere. And junior college guys were the most ready guys that we could get to get the program going. But if you look, take a careful look, we didn't really recruit all that many junior college guys. But at the end, we didn't.
Are they different? Just that influx from a transfer?
What, junior college guys?
Yeah.
I came to love junior college guys. You know, those are guys that come from riding in a van, getting a cheese sandwich and a Coke for the ride back. I mean, driving in a van, sitting in a van with seven, eight guys in a van, driving sometimes 3-4 hours, play a game, turn around, get back out, get in a van, get your cheese sandwich and Coke and get back in the van. You got to appreciate that. You know, you appreciate their willingness to do that. So I kind of like those guys. And when they got with us, they were so much more appreciative of what they had. And you know what I mean? I mean, they were – our guys kind of – our four-year guys at times kind of – and, I mean, we had the best. I mean, we had all the Jordan stuff, the top-line Jordan stuff. I mean, we were the Jordan team. And so we got pretty much whatever came out first. But it just seemed like, I think, as guys, you know, their third, fourth year, whatever, they didn't appreciate it near as much as what those first-year guys did.
Coach, you said you guys had to go into the portal in the off season because of your personnel. Say 5-10 years ago, what would you guys have been able to do?
Bad junior college guys.
Change parameters a little bit. I'm just listening to you talk about junior college guys, and you talk about how the second year is much better. Guys like Malik and Polly and Kerrigan presumably will be better next year, but a lot of their year is spent.
Not going to be here.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. So, like, do you almost have to favor guys who have multiple years over 1 year?
I would rather.
Yeah.
I would much rather.
Is the number of junior college guys that are going to be recruited, not just by you, but nationally, going to take a hit because portal guys are now available? You think there'll be fewer JUCOs get the shot?
I honestly don't know. The portals kind of become the thing that everybody talks about, that everybody, and I guess probably maybe in a way you're getting guys, you play more games maybe, you know, as or you play more games in environments that are harder to play in than doing junior college when you're playing in, you know, before 100 people or 150 people, and then all of a sudden you walk into Lubbock and the place is full.
I haven't had a chance to ask you about Leland Bird. Obviously, you would have been playing when he was the AD, so your memories of him and your thoughts of him when on his passing.
He was great to me. He was, you know, you see him in the hall and he'd stop and talk to you, and he knew my academic background. I think because a lot of those guys knew my father, the professors, you know, and things, and so, and he talked to those people. I know he would come up and say some things to me that I'm like, how did he know that, you know? But he was great, and we didn't have a grad assistant after I graduated, and I'm scrambling around trying to figure out what I'm going to do, and he started a graduate assistantship so that Jody could hire me as a grad assistant and finished my master's degree. The athletic department paid for my master's degree in the summer after my 5th year, you know, as a grad student or what, graduate assistant. It was just a couple classes, but it's really nice that he would do that. He took me. We were playing in the whatever it was. I forget what league we were in. But anyways, we were playing in Pittsburgh. And he said, we've got some boosters across the street. I'd appreciate if you come over and spend some time with them. You know? And I did. And got to meet some wonderful people, wonderful West Virginia people, because of Dr. Bird. And he always kind of kept in touch. I'd get a note from him. You know, I was here for a year with Jody and then went to Ohio State. And I'm at Ohio State for 2 years as an assistant there. And I would get a note from Dr. Bird. You know, been watching, you know, your team's doing well. Hope you're enjoying the experience and, you know, that kind of thing. So, he was great to me. I mean, just absolutely phenomenal to me.
Am I timing right? Would if he have coached at Glenville when your dad was at AB? You ever talk about that, crossing paths?
No. No, I don't know.
57, I think, was his first year at Glenville. Okay. When was your dad's last year at AB?
I don't know.
You've been around.
I had four sisters and two brothers I had to take care of. Anyway, I figured Charles could do his own stuff, you know.
ECBL was the league you were in back in.
Yeah.
Eastern Collegiate Basketball League. Then it went to the ECAC, then the A-10. Eastern 8.
Eastern 8 was the one that we should have been in the NCAA tournament. That's the one that Georgetown threw in from three-quarter court.
That's right. Yep. Remember that.
Mm-hmm. Went over to see
some longer fingernails, right?
Yeah, longer fingernails or a better free throw shooter, one of the two. But yeah, I went over there and John Thompson came over to me and he said, you know, I keep a photo of you in my office. I said, no, you don't. He said, yes, I do. He said, come on, I'll show you. Took me in his office and it's a picture of me. I'm running underneath the basket. I don't know why I was. Filled the shot that just went in from three-quarter court.
This was his first NCAA tournament team. First of his career.
Yeah, it was Coach Thompson's, yeah.
Yes.
His first NCAA tournament, yeah. We had a game won. Missed a bunch of free throws.
Anything else?
Bob, how's everybody's mood? Three in a row, but you have a lot of opportunities left.
They don't seem a whole lot different. I guess. Like, I don't know. We've got things that we've got to fix. I know that.
You'd said a bunch during the season that you were concerned if those guys from other levels would be able to handle it. You have a couple of veterans who've been through something like this before, too, but just how... How new is this for the new guys, and how much of older guys maybe helped keep it more level than three in a row could leave it?
I don't think we have very much experience at this. Most of the returning guys didn't play all that much. I mean, if you think about it, Taz didn't play all that much. This is I think more of a new experience for Sean. I mean, those two guys now are the hunted, you know. Before, they were just kind of a name on the roster. I just don't know. And I think this goes along with what you all were talking about, the portal. I don't know if we're as hungry, you know. You know, when it's just a stopover, you don't get too excited about it. I wouldn't guess.
Is invested the word they use today?
Is what?
Invested.
Yeah, that's probably a good word.
Saturday, you sort of talked about shakeups post game. Any lineup changes in the rotation starting? Are you gonna do anything different tomorrow?
I'm not sure yet. We're gonna practice again today.
Do you start showing them anything or talking to them at all about the tournament projections? I know you've said you'd like to have a good idea so they know where they stand, but is it too early?
I've talked to them about it since the first day of practice. See, I kind of felt like as a player, if we had known more, we might have as a team played harder, worked harder. We never knew anything. And I never wanted to do that to our guys. So from the jump, I told the guys at Walsh what we had to do to get in the tournament at Walsh. told the guys at Akron what we had to do. Told them at Cincinnati, told them at Kansas State, and I've told them here. I think you should do that. I think the worst thing would be those guys coming up to you later on and saying, man, I wish you would have told me.